Okay, let's get started then. Hello to everybody in the room. Hello to those of you also on YouTube watching this stream. To the first RITMO Seminar Series of this semester, of the autumn as well. It's an absolute pleasure to be able to introduce Michiel Kamp. Michiel is an assistant professor of musicology at Utrecht University, where he teaches on music and audiovisual media. Michiel is co-founder of the UK-based Ludo Musicology Research Group, which has organized yearly conferences on video game music in the UK and abroad since 2011. And he has co-edited a volume titled Ludo Musicology Approaches to Video Game Music based on these conferences. His research currently centers on video game music and other screen media with a particular interest in phenomenologies and hermeneutics of listening. His monograph, titled Four Ways of Hearing Video Game Music, is set to be published by Oxford University Press in 2024. So please, everybody, join me in giving a very warm welcome to Michiel Kamp.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm very honored to be invited to this. I'm, as a musicologist working on audiovisual media, I am working in a kind of an interdisciplinary capacity, sort of crossing musicology and media studies, musicology and game studies, but this is a much more interdisciplinary group, of course. And I'm just looking forward to hearing what you kind of make of these ideas. The focus of today will be on synchronization, specifically musical synchronization in audiovisual media, from a kind of like historical perspective, looking at how this has been done in sort of traditional audiovisual media like film and music video, and looking and comparing this to more contemporary audiovisual media, specifically video games and internet video, to the extent that that is a kind of a medium on its own. Just before I get started, like, I have a really large amount of videos, video examples that I'd like to show you. They're all quite short to sort of focus in on specific instances of synchronization, but some of them I've kind of like made a little bit too long, so I have to cut them off. So apologies for the sudden sort of cut off of image and sound every now and then as I cut a video short every now and then in the next hour or so. To give you an overview of kind of the aspects of synchronization that I'll be talking about in the next hour. So as I mentioned, first of all, I'm sort of emphasizing a process of remediation from traditional audiovisual media, specifically film, music, and music video, to more recent examples, although we can argue that video games have been around for a long time now as well, and then even more recently, internet video. And then I'll be focusing to a greater and or lesser extent on three aspects of these and this process, namely technology, aesthetics, and theory. Technology is probably the thing I'll be focusing on least of all, specifically the technology surrounding sound film. I won't go very in depth into that issue. Although thinking about sort of the technological requisites for certain developments in synchronization and musical synchronization is an interesting sort of practice in its own right. And then the aesthetics and theory will come up in terms of aesthetics, in terms of what is good synchronization, what is good about synchronizing music and image. And then finally, theory, how have people thought about why we synchronize music and image? What is synchronization of music and image? Those are the things I'll be focusing on most of all. I'll start off with two quite sort of classic quotes from theorists writing on this on this sort of phenomenon. I'll have some sort of long quotes at the beginning of the presentation, and I'll move on to shorter quotes and longer and more videos towards the end of the presentation, mostly for the purpose of like giving you examples, but it also might help the pace of the presentation a little bit. Synchronization and audiovisual media, the first interesting idea to start off with is Rick Altman's idea that synchronization in audiovisual media is like is in a sense a lie. We watch images and we hear sounds and we attribute those sounds as if coming from those images. We see people speaking, but the sounds are coming from our speakers, and often they were not recorded, depending on the medium that we're talking about, in the same instance as the images were recorded. With music, this idea of a lie becomes a little bit more complicated because we kind of tacitly expect or accept that this music does not come from the images, and still we connect these to each other somehow. And this is what we might call synchronization. But what exactly synchronization is a bit vague, especially if we start looking at how these theorists have been conceptualizing it. So on the development of sound film is kind of like the first point at which we start really speaking about synchronization as an important aspect of audiovisual media. So that would be around 1927, The Jazz Singer as one of the first sound films. And then we have kind of like this kind of period between silent film and sound film between 27 and 33, where you have all these experiments with how sound film should work and what exactly, what sounds we should have in sound film and what these sounds should be synchronized with. And during this time, we have people writing on their ideas on what synchronization should be. And an interesting idea and sort of like a classic thought from this about this comes from certain Soviet filmmakers, most famously Sergei Eisenstein, but some of his colleagues as well, who kind of published a statement on sound film as it was developed in Hollywood, but hadn't come to the Soviet Union yet at the time, and they had there something to say about it, namely about how sound film connected to their idea of montage. And the capitalization here is their own. It really, this statement really reads as a manifesto, essentially. And they suggest that the first experimental work with sound must be directed along the line of its distinct non-synchronization with the visual images. And only such an attack will give the necessary palpability, with which will later lead to the creation of an orchestral counterpoint of visual and oral images. So they kind of argue against the idea that sound and images should constantly be synchronized with each other, and they kind of want to argue for something like a non-synchronization, whatever that may be. Some years later, in a book, Composing for the Films, published by sort of Frankfurt School theorist Theodor Adorno and film composer, modernist composer, I should say, Hans Eisler, they have this kind of small sentence somewhere in the book, which is very critical overall of Hollywood film composition and and the Hollywood tradition in general, and they suggest that a photographed kiss cannot actually be synchronized with an 8-bar phrase, which is seems like a bit of a strange argument to make, because what exactly do you mean when this cannot be synchronized? Is a photographed kiss too short for an 8-bar phrase? Is it the other way around? And when you start reading the context of the quote, you actually start realizing that they interpret synchronization in a very different way than we might, or than even the Russian filmmakers would. This has to do with an argument against the use of melody in film music, and they suggest that the problem of melody as poetic is made insoluble by the conventionality of the popular notion of melody. Visual action in the motion picture has, of course, a prosaic irregularity and asymmetry. It claims to be photographed life, and as such, every motion picture is a documentary. As a result, there is a gap between what is happening on the screen and the symmetrically articulated conventional melody. A photographed kiss cannot actually be synchronized with an 8-bar phrase. The disparity between symmetry and asymmetry becomes particularly striking when music is used to accompany natural phenomena such as drifting clouds, sunrises, wind, and rain. These natural phenomena could inspire 19th century poets. However, as photographed, they are essentially irregular and non-rhythmic. thus excluding that element of poetic rhythm with which the motion picture industry associates them. Verlaine could write a poem about the rain in a city, but one cannot hum a tune that accompanies rain reproduced on the screen. So this has together to do with something altogether of a more artistic interpretation of what synchronization is. The idea that images on screen and film, and even in Hollywood film, are non-rhythmic, then that they're irregular, and that music, and specifically film music of the time, is more regular, and that the two somehow seem incompatible with each other. So we really have to start thinking about, okay, what is synchronization? Is it the developing in time of a music track and an image track, and that somehow, and there somehow being similarities in terms of the development of these in time, or is synchronization something broader and altogether vaguer and more artistic, namely this idea of fit, the idea that music somehow fits images? So in my teaching, I have been using a clip from the film Julia for a very long time now to have students experiment with the meaning that music contributes to images. By the film Julia is a film that does not have a musical soundtrack, what we would call like a non-diegetic musical soundtrack, so there's no music present in most of the scenes, unless that music is coming from is played by a radio or a musician on screen. And this allows students and researchers to experiment by putting different musical soundtracks on these images in order to see what kind of meanings the music creates in conjunction with the images. This experiment has been called forced marriage, like the forced marriage between music and images by Michiel Kamp. Just for the sake of time, I'm not going to show you the original clip, which does not have any music in it, but I'm going to show you two separate clips. And I usually ask the question sort of, how is, what is going on in this scene? Like, how would you tell the story of this scene depending on what music is present? But I also, for the focus of this talk, I want to ask the question, how is the music synchronized with these images? So here's the first clip. It's about a little over a minute. Just for a bit of context, the music used in these two sequences, which many have remarked upon, seems to fit the images quite well. The top left one is a piece by Ennio Morricone for one of the 1960s Western films, and I forgot which one. The top right one is from Thomas Newman for Shawshank Redemption, originally, used in a completely different context. But the music seems to fit these images well, but contribute different meanings to the image. Like we interpret the movements of the boy and the relationship between the boy and the woman in a different manner depending on the music used, which is quite obvious. In terms of synchronization, we might wonder, does this mean that the tracks are synchronized? And what does it mean to say that the soundtrack and the image track are synchronized in these two examples? Both seem to work around a specific moment, almost a point of synchronization that kind of stands out. The top left track had the big climax in the middle of the sequence, which seemed to sort of align with the wide angle shot of the mountain range, with the woman saying, "I see you." And then the second had like a clear sort of two-part structure with the music kind of flipping from something that was kind of long strings, a sort of long stretched string melody, to more a pizzicato piece that seemed to sort of align with the movements of the boy. Even though we could of course say that the boy was kind of moving along these mountains long before the pizzicato bit came in. And yet it was these kind of like specific moments, the kind of switch from legato to pizzicato in the top right, and the climax moment in the top left, that seemed to create what I'm going to call in a few slides a point of synchronization that seemed to align and create synchronization between these two, between image and music, for both sequences, even though the music was quite different. So, is this synchronization, and how does this exactly work? So theorists have sort of come up with concepts to talk about this. Most famously, Michiel Chion in the mid-90s, early 90s actually, the translation of the book was in the mid-90s, came up with this idea of synchresis or synchresis, which is the sort of combination between synchrony and synthesis. This idea that you, I'll just put it in Chion's words, the spontaneous and irresistible weld produced between a particular auditory phenomenon and a visual phenomenon when they occur at the same time. The classic example of this is the McGurk effect, and I'm not sure if I need to explain this to the psychologists in the room, but here's a very brief clip from a BBC documentary. It's 30 seconds, that if you don't know what it is, this will make clear.
Ba, ba, ba.
Have ba, a look at this. Ba, what do you ba, hear?
Ba, ba, ba. Ba, ba, ba.
But look what happens when we change the picture.
Ba, ba, ba. Ba, ba, ba. Ba.
And yet, the sound hasn't changed. In every clip, you are only ever hearing ba with a B.
Ba, ba.
So, the McGurk effect is the idea that visuals in create meanings or change the way we perceive sounds, specifically when we're talking about seeing someone speak and hearing someone speak. And Chion kind of translates this, or rather people who have discussed Chion, like Kevin Donnelly, whose quote is the other one on this slide, and they compare this to the McGurk effect, but of course the McGurk effect is very specific, whereas the idea of music and images occurring at the same time, we have to sort of wonder, like, what exactly are we talking about when we're talking about the same time? Are we talking about exact same time of occurrence of musical events as visual events, events, or is there more leniency between the two? And this is why Kevin Donnelly comes up with the idea of plesiochrony, this idea of sort of a middle ground of synchronization, not a non-synchronization, not a close synchronization that is that we might call synchresis, but somewhere in the middle. And he suggests that this appears regularly in crowd scenes and backgrounds in city street scenes. In fact, it appears in all places where a general noise is required that is vaguely consonant with expectations of what should emanate from the visuals. It might also easily be argued that much incidental music in films, like the one we saw on the previous slides, has a plesiochronous character. This is because incidental music can be only approximately synchronized to action. And here's that idea that we cannot have full synchresis. This is suggests that most, if not all, music in audiovisual media is plesiochronous to a certain extent. But that's not a very useful way of talking about it, because there's in that middle ground between synchrony and non-synchrony, there's all kinds of forms of synchronization that might be useful to sort of chart out. And this is exactly what Michel Chion did, focusing specifically on the idea of a point of synchronization. So in sound film, particularly early sound film, music was mostly implemented and composed through a click track, which is this idea that you kind of punch holes in the film stock, which create like a metronome sound that a composer slash conductor could conduct the orchestra to, which creates moments that you could work towards where the musical events synchronize with visual events. So, which in sort of Hollywood film scoring terminology you would call a hit, like hitting certain moments in the image track with musical events, and you create a click track to sort of work up towards these hits. Here's a brief clip from a documentary on the film The Informer by John Ford, with a soundtrack from Max Steiner, who is infamous or famous in the early days of the sound film, so 1935, for working from a very close synchronization with a lot of these hits used through the use of a click track.
Max was the click track, but only he wore the clicks. We didn't wear them. Later on we did, but at the beginning he wore them to keep himself where he wanted to be with the film. And also to match a door slamming, you know, whatever he wanted to catch. It was all clicked out for him. Click, 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 click. One, two, three, four. And that's what you conduct to.
So you also heard how you can create accelerandi in the final bit of the sequence, but you probably also saw a couple of these hits. The first one, the striking of the match against the lamppost, and then there was another one with the cut to the man through the different shots, the man with the hat, and then there was another, the flat cap, and then there was another one of the man blowing smoke into the woman's face. This from a what is sort of from a production slash composition perspective called a hit, from a theoretical slash sort of aesthetic audience perspective, experiential perspective, is what Michel Chion calls a point of synchronization, or a sync point, a salient moment of an audiovisual sequence during which a sound event and a visual event meet in synchrony. It's a point where the effect of synchresis is particularly prominent, rather like an accented chord in music. Which is interesting, because Chion actually suggests that synchresis occurs as a kind of like, also in between these points of synchronization, where synchronization is looser, and where Donnelly might speak of plesiochrony, Chion still suggests that there is synchresis, that kind of these sync points, they kind of act as a kind of like upholstery for the for a synchronization in sound film. And the idea that sound film has this kind of ebb and flow between synchronization and non-synchronization, or rather from sync point to sync point, is what people have kind of started to suggest following Chion. Chion also identifies different kinds of sync points, like the unexpected double break in the audiovisual flow, which is what you get when you get like a hard cut from one sequence to the next that is not just visual but also auditory. So also between in the music you get a hard cut from one shot to another or one sequence to another, but also like a form of punctuation at the end of a sequence, like for instance an accelerando or a climax like the one you got in one of the like the top left of the Julia clips. And then there's also the idea that you sort of have a certain sforzando, which is the idea of a stinger chord in horror films, which is one important sync point that people are talking about. So you have this idea of ebb and flow on the one hand, and the idea of syncresis and sort of plesiochrony on the other hand. There is the problem of, and this is more of an aesthetic problem of synchronization, which we find in the idea of Mickey Mousing, which is the suggestion that there is almost a too close synchronization with like a too many sync points between music and image that was kind of found as a criticism against compositional styles like Steiner's for The Informer. And this comes from a particular way of film scoring that you find in some very early sound films, like particularly the Disney animated shorts, the Silly Symphonies, of which the Skeleton Dance, but also the early Mickey shorts are an example of. And this is where the music essentially synchronizes with each movement that you see on the screen, like here. Ask the critical questions like, why was the music not synchronized with the two times that the cats were moving up and down just before the skeleton came up from behind the gravestone? So even here, there's like, we can say it's like, well, there's not complete synchronization. So here also artistic choices have been made to tell a particular story, namely the rising of the skeleton in this particular shot. But this has been sort of like laid, put as a criticism to scoring techniques in live action film like those of Max Steiner's, who kind of like adopts this following of movement by the music briefly in this scene. A little bit too much, as some critics would have said. And the idea that synchronization is somehow this idea of Mickey Mouse and this following of music and musical events and image events is therefore a problematic one. So Donnelly talks about synchronization in terms of isomorphism, drawing on ideas from Gestalt psychology, suggesting that film and music and film as moving image certainly have aspects in common. Both are temporal structures of dynamics, and both have manifested highly conventional mainstream forms. particularly montage in terms of film and musical forms in music and film music particularly. So these are certain ideas on synchronization that kind of raise questions about like what close synchronization is or should be, what kind of aesthetic aspects does this have. And it's worth comparing this briefly with another theory, not necessarily specifically of musical synchronization, but of musical media, meaning in audiovisual media, which comes from Nicholas Cook in his 1998 Analyzing Musical Multimedia. And he presents a theory of music and image that is not just about syntax, about sort of the synchronization in time of musical events, visual events, but also about semantics, how meaning is created through the relationship between music and images. He draws upon a theory from psychologists, Annabel Cohen, Sandra Marshall and Annabel Cohen from the late 80s, who suggest that, coming to the suggestion that Cook coming to the suggestion that music works as two terms, music and image work as two terms in a metaphor would work. And suggesting that if music through a structural similarity directs attention to feature A of the film and provides information about connotation X, then connotation X might come to be associated with feature A. He compares this to how metaphors work. Building on ideas of Lakoff and Johnson on conceptual metaphors, suggesting that what is essential to musical media, musical meaning in audiovisual media is not similarity between music and between things in the music and things in the images, but difference. It is built upon similarity, what he calls an enabling similarity, but this is only enabling. The actual meaning comes from differences. And this is how a metaphor works as well. So if you suggest, if you have the metaphor love is war, there are certain similarities between love and war, that there are two parties involved, and this allows certain differences between love and war to create meaning. So the difference between war and love is that there is more generally assumed to be more confrontation between in war than in love, but this suggests that perhaps love has aspects of confrontation as well. Love is a pot of noodles, has less enabling similarities, but we might think about how a pot of noodles is comfort food, and therefore love is comfortable as well, for instance, or noodles are complicated and entangled things, and therefore love has these as well, and so on and so on and so on. So less enabling similarities, and then love is a gecko. It's this idea, it's like, well, what are even the similarities at all between love and a gecko? You can have to think about these very carefully to come up with these, and therefore there are not enough to create this transfer of attributes. In kind of like in the relationship between words and images, we have this as well with the sort of the classic example of Maluma and Takete, where there are certain sort of connections that we have between words and images that are similarities that are important to allow differences than to create meanings between these, to create meanings from these two. We kind of would all, people would generally agree that Takete is the top one and Maluma is the bottom one, suggesting that there are certain like essential relations between words and images that people share. And this is what he says, look, there are certain essential relations between music and images, what Donnelly might call isomorphism, that can work to be these enabling similarities, but from that, the differences between music and image create meaning. So one of these enabling similarities for Cook is this idea of a parallelism of process. And you can compare this again with Donnelly's isomorphism. And he finds different levels of parallelism in this regard. So the idea of an iconicity of process would be like Mickey Mousing, where there's like an iconic relationship where between the music and the images, like movements that happen in the images happen in the music as well. On a broader level, we might talk about parallelism of process as a kinesis of genre. A very useful example of that is the use of Strauss in 2001, A Space Odyssey, where certain aspects of the genre of music, of the waltz, can be identified in the movements on screen, in this case, the sort of graceful rotations of objects in space. One that I'm going to cut off because we, you know, the deal with Strauss in space. What Cook then suggests is that from this enabling similarity of these graceful movements, we can have a transfer of attributes from Strauss to these futuristic objects, because there's also a difference in the sense of Strauss being classical music, being used in a science fiction setting, and certain attributes of the sort of the grandeur of Strauss can then be applied to the space stations and spaceships in 2001, A Space Odyssey. So this is a kinesis of genre. Structural kinesis then is on an even bigger, a broader level, the idea that there's like a relationship between musical form, like say an ABA structure or an AB structure, and a certain form shape in the images. Like, for instance, the relationship that we found in the Julia clips, where you have an AB form in the top right clip, and the suggestion that this creates an AB form in the images of the boy sort of climbing and his climbing somehow becoming more playful in the second part of the clip. Very briefly, where Cook built his ideas on the theories of Marshall and Cohen built their ideas on the gestalt psychology of Heider and Simmel. So eventually this idea of isomorphism is sort of the ground for both these, both these theories of music and image. Moving from film to music video, we can just ask a couple of sort of like broad questions before we move to a different medium. First of all, like the idea of like syntax and semantics, like the idea of you have these syntactical enabling similarities in terms of structure and a transfer of semantic attributes, like where does one end and the other begin? Is synchronization always syntactical, or is there also like something essential in terms of semantics in synchronization? We could suggest that synchronization kind of has a kind of magnetic, a sopping up quality to it, in the sense that a single sync point in the music, like for instance in the top left clip with this climax, sort of sops up the meaning of the image in terms of what's happening around it. But is that then creating a certain transfer of attributes, where attributes of the music, namely this sort of like this kind of like threatening kind of qualities of the minor climax, do they then get transported upon the music in that moment? And also, we can ask a question like, when is structural kinesis determined? Pathway through a sequence or by individual sync points? Because the AB structure that we had in the top right clip kind of suggests that there is a certain sync point, namely the moment from which you go from A to B, which then creates that structure. And then finally, if synchronization is semantic, what is the importance of film narrative for the experience of synchronization? The idea that we want to sort of attribute a narrative, a relationship between the boy and his mother, does that change the way we experience synchronization, or does it determine the way we experience synchronization in these two clips? And this idea of film narrative allows us to sort of make the transition to music video a little bit easier, because traditionally music video has been kind of like seen as in many ways the opposite of film, where in film you have a narrative told by images and music is sort of like added to these in order to change the meaning of the narrative or in order to influence the meaning of the narrative. In music video, we kind of have the idea to, that this is somehow the opposite, that you have music and images are somehow added to this music in order to change the meaning of the music. So one interesting point to make is that music video, whereas we kind of like tend to suggest that music video sort of came about with the start of MTV in the 1980s, the history of music video is actually a lot longer, and depending how you define it, music video is actually almost as long as sound film itself. The first sound film, The Jazz Singer, only had sound, synchronized sound, in the musical numbers of that film. And a music like musical like 42nd Street had certain production numbers which were distinct from the rest of the film's narrative to suggest that it was really sort of a narrative film with short music videos in between. And if you look at these musical numbers with the choreography by Busby Berkeley, you kind of can analyze these as sort of like proto music videos, or even just as music videos. Obviously, you had a relationship between the musical climax and the slight rallentando at the end, and the fact that the camera sort of slowed down in front of the to create a close-up of the protagonists. And then, if you look closely at the cuts in the sequence, they kind of followed the structure of the music. So there was a clear kind of structural kinesis going on there as well, in addition to obviously the dancers and the movements of the bodies being synchronized with the music. Another interesting predecessor that I'm not going to spend too much time on of the music video, or sort of like early instance of the music video, came in the form of these visual jukeboxes that you had in the 1940s in the New York area. You had these experiments of the Panorama jukebox in the 1960s, coming from France, but also I think were experiments with applying this in the US with the Scopitone. But then, more importantly for the history of the music video were these promo videos that were cut by artists who were first appearing on live television shows, but later on, just for instance, the popularity of the Beatles made them sort of create little kind of like recordings of their performances that they would then share with late night television hosts like Ed Sullivan to show rather than appearing live. And it was these videos that were later used on MTV at the very beginning of the television network in the 1980s. But interesting, in these sort of early promo videos in the 1960s, we find like a very early one, We Can Work It Out by the Beatles, and then one only a year later, Paperback Writer. And if you look at the way music is synchronized with the images, there is again like a very sort of tight synchronization in terms of cuts appearing. You paid attention to the editing. There were some clear sync points that were being created in these triplets that you had. A more subtle one was the fact that there were hard cuts between shots apart from the sort of like entrance of the next sort of the next section of the music, which was a slow dissolve actually at the end. So there's these kind of like really sort of slavish following of the music in terms of synchronization, but this sort of creates also the opportunity to experiment, which you see at the beginning of Paperback Writer, which is no longer just sort of following the performance of the music and who is singing and who is playing, but also is starting to play around with that a little bit. I was particularly referring to the sudden cut to the shot of the statue rather than any member of the Beatles, which sort of on such a prominent moment in the music creates these sudden questions like, what does this mean? So synchronization creating a question of sorts. So we might sort of, following this, we might sort of ask to what extent music video is all about sort of a tight synchronization between music and image. And this is actually, particularly nowadays, much more rare than one might think, and it doesn't quite characterize what music video is and is trying to do in terms of the synchronization of music and images. We find it is so rare that one example of very strict synchronization of musical events and image events is creates this kind of surreal quality, as you find in the video, music video for the Chemical Brothers' Star Guitar, directed by Michel Gondry. And if you start looking closely at this train journey, you'll find that it's not actually a train journey at all. I'll just play 30 seconds or so. Mesmerizing to look at this. Obviously, each object in the environment is a layer or an instrument or a musical device sort of entering. And this is kind of following in the tradition of Fischinger's optical poems that he started making in the 1930s, sort of animations which are almost like a formalistic depiction of musical, classical music pieces. These are rare and almost like an ideal of synchronization. That what James Tobias suggests, that you find these in the history of synchronization. You find these ideas of like a very close. It's hard to even talk about this in terms of Mickey Mousing, because there's nothing, kind of no creatures moving or persons moving on the screen. But this very close isomorphism between music and images, you find this appearing every now and then as a kind of like ideal to strive towards, but in reality what most synchronization consists of is much more plesiochronic, as Donnelly would suggest. And Cook captures the particular kind of synchronization that you find in music video very well by suggesting that it is actually a mix between the cinematic and the performance. The performative axis, one pole of which is the apparently unmediated presentation of the artist in performance, and the other the apparently unmediated presentation of a cinematic narrative. Alteration between these two is, and the blurring of distinction is a standard function of music videos. Very briefly, the first 30 to 50 seconds or so of Old Town Road, in which you see what is the montage, the editing kind of picking aspects from the montage of a performance and the montage of a narrative film. I'm going to narrate over this a little bit, so I'm going to turn the volume down and sort of try and show you what is going on a little bit. So starting off with kind of camera slowly panning along shots of people looking at something, which creates this expectation. What are they looking at?
Yeah, I'm gonna take my horse to the old town road. I'm gonna
film
ride till I can't no more. I'm gonna take my horse to the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more.
I got the horses in the back. Horse stock is attached. Head is matted black. Got the boots black to match. Riding on a horse. Been in the valley, you ain't been up off that porch. Now can't nobody tell me nothing. You can't tell me nothing.
So what you see is, at the same time, you see Lil Nas X singing at the camera as if this were a performance, and at the same time you see kind of this shot reverse shot relation between people looking somewhere, and then where are they looking at? It's being answered by suddenly you see someone appearing in the Los Angeles suburbs on a horse in cowboy outfit, and this is more of like an aspect of film editing. So at the same time, you see these kind of really sort of like salient synchronization points, like the horse getting on his hind legs, forget the name in English, and landing on the beat, on the downbeat, which kind of like, again, acting as a kind of upholstery of the whole sequence. So this alteration between cinematic editing and synchronization and performance editing is the actuality of what synchronization in music video is about. So how do these two media then translate and transfer these traditions of synchronization to newer media like music video and music, like internet video and video games? Just some brief concepts and ideas surrounding remediation. The term is coming from Balter and Grusin, who build this idea of remediation, this idea of using aspects from one medium into and transferring those into another. They kind of build this loosely upon the media philosophy of Marshall McLuhan, who kind of suggests that the content of a medium is always another medium. And they kind of find this these concepts around remediation, particularly immediacy and hypermediacy. So where Cook suggests that like you have these poles and opposite poles in music video, the unmediated presentation of film, and the unmediated presentation of performance. He's really talking about immediacy, the immediate presentation of we are looking at a film or at a cinematic narrative, and the immediate presentation we are looking at a performance. But at the same time, the idea that music video sort of like fluctuates between these poles and does this quite deliberately so and quite clearly so to viewers, this creates a hypermediacy, the idea that we find these two forms of presentation, of representation, performance and film and cinema, we find these so clearly in the music video, makes the music video for Balter and Grusin a hypermediate medium. So we could say that in broad terms, we might say that video games remediate a lot of aspects from film, a lot of what Lisa Gittelman would call a lot of conventions, but also protocols. The way we play video games has a lot of cinematic aspects to it. We play through a certain narrative in a video game, and affordances of film and film music as well. A game like Red Dead Redemption, which is a very clear aspect of Western cinema, like Once Upon a Time in the West, also remediates protocols from the film music of Western cinema. So here's a very brief clip from a documentary on Red Dead Redemption where the composers are talking about the musical aspects of this soundtrack.
If you jump on a horse, our bass line kicks in. When you start getting chased, timpanis roll in and big fuzz guitars roll in and there's a shootout.
So the idea of having big fuzz guitars in a Western cinema is clearly derived from the soundtracks of Ennio Morricone, like for Once Upon a Time in the West. And then we can say that internet video remediates a lot of aspects from music video by, for instance, having certain sort of TikTok trends follow Lil Nas X Old Town Road, which is also how Old Town Road got its fame. But this is altogether a little bit more complicated, and there are a lot more arrows that we can draw here. First of all, if we start looking at the kind of presence of Old Town Road on YouTube, which itself suggests that Old Town Road is, in a sense, an internet video, because really, what is the difference between any video appearing on YouTube? But you find of Old Town Road two versions, the official video and the official movie. The official video is just straight song, but the official movie has a kind of like more, again, like a Western style kind of prelude to a sequence to it that is cut and orchestra and scored like a feature film. So this suggests that there's also a clear remediation from film to music video. But the idea that these both appear in internet videos is in itself a suggestion that there's a remediation from film to internet video as well. So this suggests, again, that this idea of a straight mediation from remediation from film to video games and music video to internet video is a little bit more complex than it looks. So just looking at the time, going a little bit slow, so going to try and sort of like go through these two media and what they bring to the table themselves a little bit quicker. So video games and synchronization, one important aspect that video games have that we haven't talked about yet in music video and film is the idea of interactivity. And related to that idea of interactivity, the fact that we play a video game and that we interact with a video game and we don't with a music video or a film, creates its own issues of synchronization that are not necessarily a question of remediation. And we can talk about this in terms of interactivity and the idea of dynamic music, and we'll get to that in the next slide. But we can also talk about this in terms of play, that we are playing a video game, and so it's an a playful form of interaction. And we can talk about this in terms of ludo-literacy. We know how to play a video game, and we operationalize certain aspects of what we know about games and the narratives that they tell, and we do that from our knowledge of cinema and film music and the like. And all this comes together in this really interesting quote by William Chang, who is talking about playing the game Fallout 3, in which there is a quest to detonate a nuclear bomb in a village, and this is obviously the evil path that you can take in this video game, because you're, of course, morally challenged to not do this, and then the game presents you with all these rewards for actually doing this, and then the question is, okay, am I going to do this or not? Detonate this bomb or not? And Chang chose to detonate this bomb, and the game also has these radio stations, among one of which plays sort of very traditional American military marches, like those of John Philip Sousa. And he suggests, kind of looking at the way he was playing this game, that what never fails to strike me is how I pressed the detonator button at almost the exact same moment Sousa's march came to a close. Although I was playing a video game, I may have ended up pressing the button because curiously, it was the theatrical or cinematic thing to do. It was also the obedient thing to do. Unfortunately, I don't have a clip of this, and it would have been great, but Chang hasn't recorded, sort of like uploaded his recording of him playing and pressing this detonator button to the Sousa march. So I just have a clip of this without music, which I'm not sure how much it will show you, but just here's a video game nuclear explosion for you. here, all these aspects of interactivity, playfulness, and literacy come into play, no pun intended. But just diving into these a little bit further, first of all, one aspect of this idea of interactivity is the idea of dynamic music, music that somehow adapts to the actions of the player. And how music adapts to the actions of player depends on how the game designers and programmers and composer work together and what kind of like model or method of dynamic music or interactive or adaptive music they employ. And Red Dead Redemption has a really interesting one. So here's a little bit of a longer version of that clip from the documentary, and pay close attention to the way that they have created this dynamic music that adapts to the actions of the player.
Having researched and discovered instruments to have an authentic Western sound, the biggest challenge was finding a way of recording a score that could adapt according to decisions the player makes. So instead of songs, they composed stems.
We had to devise a method by which those stems could be used practically anywhere in the game and interact with other stems.
The team decided to create all the music at 130 beats per minute in A minor, so that the game engine can play stems on top of one another and create music on the fly.
If you jump on a horse, our bass line kicks in. When you start getting chased, timpanis roll in and big fuzz guitars roll in, and there's a shootout. The music actually changes with the action.
Getting the right combination of music and timing is essential to further connecting the player to the world that Rockstar created.
So you can imagine that for composers who are used to a little bit more freedom, having to compose everything at 130 beats per minute in A minor doesn't offer you a lot of expressive tools. And this is what you would call a method of vertical layering, when you have these kind of layers or stems of music that kind of come in depending on changes in the game state. So let's suppose we are walking around or riding around on a horse and we are in a safety state, so we play music in a safety state that is perhaps just some strings. And then when there's danger, an enemy appears, so we bring in some slightly dissonant bass and perhaps some percussion, and we kind of fade this in and out at the exact moment, synchronizing, sort of creating this structural kinesis between the presence of the enemy and their disappearance again. The other way of horizontal reorchestration is more interesting, because you kind of go from a loop that is playing when we're safe, and you're kind of switching to a different loop, going to a B section that is playing while the enemy is present, and then going back to a safety state when they're gone again. But this creates problems, because what if the enemy is appearing in the middle of a loop, or perhaps even in the middle of a bar, a measure of music? What do you do then? Do you switch to the danger state immediately, therefore sort of like creating a disruption of the musical kind of meter? Or do you wait until the end of the bar, and therefore creating this problem with synchronization, where we have a sudden switch of the music, or rather a switch of the music after the event of the appearance of the enemy has already occurred? So these are problems with synchronization that are essential to the idea of playing video games. And this also relates to the aesthetic of video game music that has been called the aesthetic of smoothness by Medina Gray, who is kind of suggesting that all these kind of attempts at dynamic music, they kind of follow this idea that the music needs to smoothly change from one section to the next. And so smoothness and synchronization are closely related in this case. Donnelly calls this way that video games work the triple lock of synchronization, not just between music and image, but between music, image, and player. And he finds that on the one hand, there's precise synchronization, which is actually quite rare because of the issues with this dynamic music composition, and actually much more common in relationship between non-musical sounds that a player makes and the buttons that a player presses. And then there's plesiochrony, which is much more common due to these issues. But there's also an interesting thing that's, and there's parallel path asynchrony. I'm just going to leave this for because of issues with time. But this is the idea that the music does something asynchronous in parallel with the actions of the player. But music-led asynchrony is an interesting one, and it has to do with the idea that there's music that doesn't react to the player, but the player is asked to react to the music. And this is in its most basic form, what we find in music games like Guitar Hero or Beat Saber. This is the idea where we're kind of playing along with music, hitting, performing actions to the beat. So we can call this entrainment. But more broadly, we can say that we even do this, we can ask whether we even do this in video games when we're not entraining to specific beats. So in the video game Super Mario Brothers, the music changes when we pick up a star power-up and we start running, but we somehow find ourselves running to this music. And this is what I then call ludic music, the idea that we're playing along to music even though we're not necessarily entraining to specific beats. So here's Mario picking up a power-up. So this is the music that we were hearing first, and then here's the music of the star power up that we're hearing afterwards, which is a much faster tempo, a much shorter loop. And somehow I'm playing along with this faster tempo, even though what I'm doing as a player, I'm just holding the controller and maybe pressing slightly harder into the B button of the controller. But my avatar, Mario, is moving faster. So this is not entrainment in the sense of my particular movements as a player, but it is somehow playing along this experience that we are following the music, this what Donnelly calls this music-led asynchrony. And this is also related to Cheng's idea that there's a certain obedience to this kind of synchronization with music that we are having in video games. We are sort of asked by the music to play along. And this also has a theatrical or cinematic or even an ethical dimension. And this brings us to the final idea, the idea of literacy in playing along, which is this idea that there is remediation involved. I'm just going to leave, for issues of time again, leave the idea of immersion out of this. In detonating a nuclear bomb to the music of John Philip Sousa, there is a certain cinematic thing to do by exploding the bomb just as the music ends. But this idea of sort of plesiochronic playing along is very much connected to the research of Kerry Miller on the music in radio stations in Grand Theft Auto, where we are kind of playing this gangster persona, which has all kinds of connotations with gangster culture in kind of like a fake imaginary Los Angeles in that is called San Andreas in the game. And we kind of like adopting these roles, this idea of mimicry by Roger Calois, we are somehow obeying the roles that the game presents us by playing along and kind of like playing along with the music on these radio stations. Miller suggests that by encouraging players to experiment with the possibilities and the confining borders of CJ's world, San Andreas invites them to interpret its controversial content on their own terms and investigate their own complicity with its stereotypes that govern much of the social life of the game world. So video games and the way that they ask us to play along and synchronize our movements to the to not necessarily the beat of the music, but certain connotations that the music has, they raise all kinds of questions of like, what is it and can we play along, and what is it to obey the music in this manner? Moving to the final medium that I want to talk about, the idea of internet video. First of all, we need to sort of make an extra arrow, because we have, of course, music games which remediate all these kind of conventions of synchronization drawn from music video. In many ways, the internet video is, even though there are many relationships between internet video and video games, in terms that people record their playthroughs and put them on YouTube. The internet video is an altogether slightly separate phenomenon. But this idea of the centrality of YouTube in all this, of all these media coming together on one platform and sort of intermingling and sort of these traditions of synchronization existing and coexisting, is very captured by Carol Vanellis, who suggests that all media from post-classical cinema to music videos and commercials start to resemble or refer to YouTube. This kind of prompts us to do a little bit of a survey of what kind of internet videos are actually present on these platforms like YouTube and Instagram, and nowadays, very importantly, TikTok as well, like you have the TikTok trend of Old Town Road. There are a lot of examples of this, and we might start with the short form video, which is usually around 30 seconds or so in length, in which synchronization plays a pretty essential role. Most of the little TikTok dances in the Old Town Road trends, they follow a very particular structure of synchronization. Here's one example.
I got the horses in the bag, horse stock is attached. Head is matted black, got the boosters black to match. Riding on a horse, you can whip your horse. I've been in the valley.
So what you saw was a double break, in Chion's words, that occurred at the exact moment that the beat dropped. And you get this kind of change in outfits and then a series of silly dances that somehow kind of make fun and make light of sort of cowboy cliches. But this double break is kind of essential and also something that we see occurring in many of these internet video kind of synchronization practices. Another, this is one of the most played and most famous of short TikTok videos, which is Bella Poarch, who is lip syncing and syncing to a kind of low key British rapper called Millie B, and sort of playing with this a personality that she's adopting, and sort of look, but also emphasizing the lip sync, and also pay attention to the camera movement in this case.
The B, it's M to the B, it's M, 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 M to the B, it's M to the B, it's M to the B.
So again, like you see a very sort of close synchronization here, not along the lines of a double break, but along the lines of more Mickey Mousing, even between camera movements and facial expressions and facial movements. This idea is also related very closely to interactivity and interaction. These trends are all about people sort of performing these videos and creating these videos and very strictly following these kind of like montage and synchronization rules of these trends. Very sorry, I'm going to skip Num Num Cat, but that would have been an example of the TikTok duet function that sort of allows a kind of iterative process of people creating music in this manner. But a relatively distant predecessor of Bella Poarch we find in the Numa Numa internet meme of someone uploading the video of themselves lip syncing to a kind of like one hit wonder in the summer of 2003 or 4, Ozone's Drago Stay Dente, very briefly. And again, like we see a very sort of clear relationship between this and the video of Bella Poarch in that there is a what Cook would call the immediacy of the performance of the artist, but at the same time this is played around with by having a almost exaggeration of movements, like a Mickey Mousing of the performance take place. And the TikTok trend by Old Town Road of this abrupt sort of cut, this double break sync point, finds a predecessor in the Harlem Shake, which here performed by the Norwegian Army. And I swear I had this video before I started preparing this talk.
Con los terroristas.
Again, like these double breaks are played with, they kind of create this they're at the center of creating this kind of like interactive trend where people exaggerate what happens, the difference between what happens before and after the break, before and after the drop. Example I'm going to skip because this is going to take a lot of explanation and content warnings. Another example I'm going to skip, just for the sake of brevity, is Nyan Cat, which is this kind of very brief animation. Well, actually, I'm going to skip it. It can be very brief, so I'm just going to very, very briefly show the kind of simplicity of internet animation as well, but also how we might ask whether this is Mickey Mousing or whether this is kind of veering into the territory of plesiochrony because of the minimal amount of distinction in movements of the little cat here. So here's very briefly a video that is very much created to go on infinitely, and there are 10-hour versions of this video on YouTube as well. Imagine. Fade this out, but the question about synchronization here is whether Mickey Mousing is just the idea of movement synchronizing with the beat of the music, or whether there should be more distinction in movement in that regard. A very clear aspect of plesiochrony that's kind of bordering on asynchrony is from a completely random cooking video on Facebook that employs stock music, library music that can be found and used all very often for free in creators' videos on YouTube and Facebook and other platforms. And that is just music that is created to be background music. And the question is whether we should call this plesiochrony because there is music present at all, or whether this is asynchrony, and whether that has to do with the imparting of meaning of the music on the images or not. Kind of videos that are made to be able to be played with the sound off as well. But then we may ask the question, is like, why have background music be there at all when we turn the sound on? So just to summarize these, we find on the one hand this idea of the double break, which is exaggerated and which is kind of enabled by these technological things like the duet function. but which also creates this idea of interaction, of like creating these trends and these memes like Harlem Shake and Old Town Road. Then we have the importance of lip sync, which is just following, of course, the idea of synchresis. And finally, how lip sync is kind of, again, taken to an extreme in many of these videos by not having people lip sync to music, but lip syncing just to the videos of other people talking and sort of appropriating their ways of moving. And at the same time, having this kind of playing with the classic speech-to-song illusion by playing these videos over and over, like playing with the musical qualities of other people's videos that are not made to be musical at all. And which suggests that there's a kind of remediation occurring here through the body as well. I'm going to leave out the assemblage bit. But which on the one hand is something that is kind of essential to drag culture, but on the other hand, also involves a kind of cultural appropriation. Bella Poarch is appropriating British rap music here, but we also find, for instance, whites, well, not just Americans, but people in general appropriating lip syncing to African American people and singers and just people uploading videos. So there's also an aspect of cultural appropriation here, but also like an exaggeration of Mickey Mousing again, if we look at the exaggerated movements, almost cartoon-esque movements, cartoon-like movements of Bella Poarch here. And then finally, we have the question to what extent stock music or just even the exaggeration of the length of these videos creates plesiochrony or asynchrony. All right, so I kind of want to end on that notion and sort of just to bring in some final, summarizing these ideas about this idea of remediating and how these traditions of synchronization are related to both the medium specifically and how these are remediated from older practices like film and music video. I'm just going to draw a red arrow between video games and internet video, because while both quite centrally feature this idea of interactivity that is not necessarily present in music video and film, that's not to say that the interactivity of video games is necessarily remediated to music to internet video, or at least I've not suggested or shown that in this presentation. But the idea of this triple lock between the player and the game and the images and the music on the one hand, or this idea of the TikTok user creating a video that is just like the earlier video in that trend, is present. And then finally, the idea that we might talk of this as a kind of cyborg aesthetics, the idea that we're in all, particularly in these TikTok videos, in these internet videos, synchronization is not just about synchronizing camera movements and film editing with musical events, but it is also about the relationship between the voice in lip syncing and the body in dance and montage. Perhaps the best example of this being the Old Town Road trend, which is both a dancing body and in close conjunction and close collaboration with his hard cut, with his hard double break. This brings the question, and again, I said this talk was going to be about questions and more, particularly in this final bullet point, more than answers, of what exactly is the relationship between syntax and semantics in synchronization practices? Because clearly, synchronization in all these videos plays an important syntactical role. Again, think about the sudden double break creating this A-B structure in all these internet videos. But at the same time, it has a semantic function as well. It imparts meaning. People play around with what a double break is in an internet video. People exaggerate as they do in the Harlem Shake. So again, like, I think I should end on this note and leave some time for questions. Hopefully I've given a good overview of all these different practices and how they might relate to each other. And thank you for your attention.
Michiel, thank you so, so much. That was fascinating. And humorous as well. There's a lot of humor involved here. This synchrony, of course, has a long history of the humor as well, which was very funny. Definitely funny, as the old Talmud performer claims.
Says, yeah.
We do have some time for questions, though, so does anyone has a burning question on the floor, we can start there. Yes, Alexander.
Thank you. That was very rich and a lot of different things. You already spoke about a lot, but I'm going to ask you about something you didn't speak much about, but perhaps you have some thoughts about, and that's the relationship between music and sound and use of sound in all of these things here, because in many cases there's also, I guess, synchronization in terms of sound, kind of versus what's going on in the visuals, etc.
Yeah.
But also relationship between sound and music, which is, can also be gliding at points. And I guess you have been thinking some about this as well.
Yeah, there's a lot to be said there. And I think, so a lot of what these theorists do, particularly Chion, does not necessarily, in his theory of synchronization in sound film, does not necessarily distinguish between music and sound. And a lot of theorists on synchronization in video game music also do not distinguish, for better and for worse, where sometimes when, for instance, they talk about the player synchronizes their movements with there's a clear synchronization or synchresis even between the player's movements and the game sound, and then they talk about the game sounds, the sounds that their avatar makes when a player jumps and we hear a leap, which, so I've deliberately left this out because it kind of models the question of synchronization a little bit, especially when we start leaping between music and sound whenever we know the answer to one and we don't know the answer to the other. And there's a lot more to be said there. I think I'm wondering what particular example I should give from what particular medium, but staying within my comfort zone of video games, a really interesting question in terms of synchronization with sound is when we start asking, I don't know if I can go back to the Mario example, but just if you still have it in your head, like what Super Mario Brothers feels like and what playing Super Mario Brothers feels like, when you jump, there's an upwards glissando. Normally when we jump in the real world, there's not an upwards glissando. And still we would call this a sound effect because it is closely related, it is closely synchronized, there's a synchresis between you pressing that button and the upward sound. In cartoon music terminology, we would call this Mickey Mousing, but because it doesn't fit the beat of the music, we would sort of ask if this is not more of a sound effect than a musical effect, even though it is a glissando and even though it doesn't really actually represent jumping. So I think there are all kinds of really interesting questions to ask in that regard. Yeah, absolutely. And I just left them out because it got way too complicated. Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions from the floor? Yes, Rainer.
Yeah, thanks for the overview. My intention is to make the picture even broader. I come from live performance studies, and a huge amount of what of the concepts you offered reminded me of identical or very similar concepts in live performance studies. Like, for instance, the counterpoint concept is used a lot in ballet choreomusicology. In interpersonal entrainment, there's this parallel study of rhythmic entrainment versus emotional entrainment, which reminds me a lot of the syntax versus semantics.
Yeah.
And to give an example from my research, the double break in music and dance from West Africa is the high point in each little drum dance solo.
Yeah.
The particularly salient point, the most salient point in time is the dual stop, like the freeze and the dance marked by what they call blocage in French, a break by the drummer. So a lot of the stuff speaks to me as a live performance researcher. And a question I always wanted to pose to a media study, so what's the rationale for starting with film exactly? Isn't this a story which starts like 100,000 years earlier with, with all ritual, all opera, all performance being multimedia, and obviously a lot of the stuff which speaks to me from media studies understood as modern, mostly electronic mass media has roots in performance.
I think you're right, and I. Again, slightly arbitrary. Most musicologists would actually say, well, you know, why start with sound film? Why not go back to opera, for instance, or musical theater, which again is a clear predecessor here. And I think you have a good example of going back even further. I kind of follow the trick that a lot of these people do when they talk about these histories by starting with a technological development, which is the development of sound film, where you have images and music or sound. And then I'd started talking about everything but technology. So I kind of like, that was a little bit of a trick to create a potentially arbitrary sort of historical starting point. But you're right, especially if you start talking about this idea of like cyborg aesthetics. Again, I put it in quotation marks because it's just, it might not be useful. But the idea that there is a clear relationship between the audiovisual technological aspects, or like the idea of editing and camera and cinematography, and dance in these TikTok dances. Looking at the dance aspect of that, I think it is very important to also start talking about dance that is not recorded, visually recorded, audiovisually recorded. And I think it is very interesting to ask, what is the relationship between like a double break in African dance and a double break in these TikTok videos? And it's fascinating, and it's something to really be really worth leaping into, especially if you're looking at the dance aspect of this story. Yeah.
Okay, and we certainly have time for a few more questions as well, if people do have any burning questions. Can I jump in then quickly? How quickly we jump in. In terms of the video game playing, that quote from Cheng was extremely interesting about this agency that comes about from the dynamic music and from the interactive possibilities of gaming.
Yeah.
Something very sinister
about
this, of course, that comes about. Gosh, it brings to mind the kind of dissonances from film like Clockwork Orange or something between horrifying imagery, kind of beautiful or sublime musical. I wonder if you've talked to lots of game players about this, or whether this is widely reported about the increasing agency that dynamic music can give to a player.
Yeah, I personally have not. Well, I have not in an ethnographic manner. I have sort of colloquially, like informally, talked to people about it. I know that Cheng and particularly Kiri Miller have done a lot of research into this. Kiri Miller's I went over through her ideas a little bit quickly, but she has done an extensive study on how people use the radio stations in Grand Theft Auto, and sort of how they pick their radio stations, because you play like a kind of like a black young man from the streets of virtual Los Angeles, so there are certain expectations of what someone like that would listen to, and those radio stations are present. You play it in the early 1990s, so there is a sort of a gangster rap radio station which allows you to play to Snoop Dogg and whomever. But there's also a country music station, so you can subvert this idea by having your character play along to country music and whatnot, and Miller goes into in depth about sort of the ethical implications and the implications of like playing to and playing with, and this distinction between playing to and playing with, I find is actually quite central also in other people's writings, like Cheng, who finds himself playing to the music, where the music actually seems to be limiting his agency in a sense. And this is what I talk about in my book as well, this idea of ludic music, which is on the one hand has this kind of like clear sort of playfulness and this idea of freedom to play with whatever the music presents us. But on the other hand, there is a lack of agency, a giving up of agency to the music if you're playing to the music as well, where we're adopting a certain persona in our playing to this music in order to enjoy the music more. But this sort of like, this is the opposite of playing against the grain, as it were. It's the playing with the grain, like following what the music wants us to do, in a sense. Yeah.
Thank you, it's very interesting. Yes, as I interjected, I think I interrupted, I'm so sorry.
I was thinking about tempo, because it just hit me that, for example, with a cooking video, the background music is very, can you talk about synchronization with tempo?
Yeah.
Because it's kind of in sync.
Yeah, in a although, way. Again, this is, again, I think this is a really good instance where plesiochrony is a really useful term, because there is no direct relationship between, again, in that video, between the movements of the things being cooked on screen. I think it was slightly sped up to sort of like allow the viewer to go through the motions of the cooking, or like through the steps of the cooking process quicker. And there's no direct synchronization to the beat, as in there's no specific movements to the beat. But if you experience there to be a synchronization there, and that this is an upbeat tempo music, I think that is exactly what Donnelly would say. Well, there's plesiochrony there, because there's a sort of relationship between the tempo of the music and the tempo of the actions on screen, but it's not a one-to-one relationship, or it's not as Cook would call iconicity of process, or Mickey Mousing. But this kind of relative tempo is also, for instance, what was at play in that Super Mario video, where you had a slower section before picking up the power-up, and then a faster section, and then you could play to the speed, the faster speed, by moving faster yourself. But there's no kind of like absolute tempo that's being set there. So I think, yeah, it's relative, and it's also in the perception of the viewer a little bit in that sense. So yeah, I think plesiochrony is a useful way of thinking about that, yeah.
I think there was a question at the back. Yes, this may have to be our last one for today.
Great, yeah, thank you for a really interesting talk. And I was just, it just kind of hit me, you're talking about a lot of parts of, or different aspects of media, and I was wondering if you had considered maybe a generational or a sign of, kind of you touched on it before, playing with versus, like along with, versus yeah. manipulating it yourself. Like, I think about the kids who are growing up with TikTok, and yeah. their immediate idea of hearing a song is like, how they can coordinate their own movements or how they can clip a video. And I wonder if we see this as people who are growing up now who have always had this quick availability to manipulate and kind of create their own meaning out of a movie scene, for example.
Yeah.
How that can kind of play out in different forms of media.
Yeah, that's an interesting one, because it does, this is kind of, I think maybe in one of the last, oh, is it here? Yes. Oh yeah, participation, like this idea of participatory culture, which is kind of Henry Jenkins' concept from 2006-ish, which is right around the time you get these internet 2.0 interactive platforms and the like appearing. I think it is, there is a general irrational thing, perhaps. Again, like I haven't done any empirical research on this, and I can't recall any numbers, but there might still be a gap, even independent of generations, between those who purely watch TikTok videos and those who feel compelled to participate in these trends. But even then, we can still ask, of those participating in the trends, I think one interesting question to ask is, to what extent are they playing to the trend or playing with the trend? When there is something like the Old Town Road video, if you are creating a video of yourself dressing up as a cowboy, dancing, and then creating a hard cut, are you playing to that trend or playing with that trend? At what point are you starting playing with it? For instance, like, are you doing away with the hard cut and doing a, I don't know, trying to change clothes as quickly as possible somehow. Like this kind of playing to and playing with is perhaps a useful way of sort of like distinguishing between the ways that even within that participatory culture, different forms of participation exist and whatnot. But yeah, it certainly is a good suggestion to think of this as a generational thing as well, where it might be that people grow up with these social media and find themselves more easily invited to play along in those trends than those of us. I'm not sure what generation I would be, but that have grown up with more traditional broadcast media, mass media, where there's clear creators and clear consumers. Yeah.
Thank you so much. So all that's left for me to say, firstly, is thank you to all of you in the room for coming along and for joining the YouTube stream as well. And finally, thank you to Dr. Michiel Kamp. Thank you very much for a wonderful talk.